राष्ट्रीय न्यायिक सेवा प्राधिकरण
न्यायालयातल्या कारवाई खातीर बरो वकील मेळून दिता.
वेळार योग्य कायदा खालची मदत आणि सल्लो दिता.
लोक अदालत द्वारा चढ काळच्या केसीक बेगीन सोपयता.
आणि ते बी सामके मोफत.
राष्ट्रीय न्यायिक सेवा प्राधिकरण बेस बरो न्याय बेस बरो समाज.
अधिक माहिती खातीर लागच्या न्यायालयातल्या न्यायिक सेवा प्राधिकरण कार्यालयाला लागी संपर्क करा
वा टोल फ्री नंबर 1500 चे फोन करा.
Hello everyone, I'm Advocate Rohan Desai. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to yet another session of virtual Judicare series organized by the Goa State Legal Services Authority. Today, we have Advocate Swati Kamath who is going to enlighten us on the topic interpretation of statutes. Well, interpretation of statutes is a correct understanding of the law and in this process is commonly adopted by the courts of law for determining the exact intention of the legislature. Because the objective of the court is not only merely to read the law, but is also to apply it in meaningful manner to suit from case to case. So here we have Advocate Swati Kamath.
Today, we are discussing interpretation of statute. The word interpretation has been derived from a Latin word interpretari. In simple language, to interpret means to explain, expound meaning of something so as to understand it completely or constructively. Statute meaning a written law passed by a legislative body, for example Parliament of India. State also passes its own laws. Legally speaking, interpretation of statute means the process of finding out the true sense of an enactment by giving the words of the enactment their natural and ordinary meaning. Constitution of India has not particularly used this word as statute, but it uses the word term law for denoting the actions of the legislature and its primary power. Maxwell's interpretation of statutes has defined statute as the will of the legislature. An essence of the law lies in the spirit, not in its letter, but the letter are the only way in which intentions are expressed. The words are external manifestation of the intention that it involves. When there is possibility of one or more interpretation of statute, court has to adopt the interpretation which reflects the true intention of the legislature, which we normally refer to as the legal meaning of statutory provisions. Why we need to interpret a statute? The necessity to interpret arises if the words in a statute are not clear or are unambiguous, inconsistent or incomplete, thereby leading to confusion. In many cases, wordings in a statute is lacking in clarity and precision and thus giving rise to controversy. When the vagueness of a statute is under challenge, we also require to interpret it. The object of interpretation. What is the object of interpreting a statute? Law is like an ocean. As lawyers, we dive in and dive out of different statutes only to help our clients with the given narrative of facts or bundle of facts so as to make out a case that appeals to judges and eventually to succeed in the matter. Hence, this process of interpretations becomes very relevant, evaluating and continuous. Therefore, the object of interpretation of statute is to know the intention of the legislature conveyed expressly or impliedly in the language used and apply the same to a given case where it is necessary to do so. Sometimes, at first in reading, one understands wordings in a particular manner and sometimes we read again and again to achieve the best objective of the interpretation. Test is simplified. If there is reading material available for interpretation, maybe in a different form, but it is made difficult when one is called upon to interpret for the first time. Sometimes there might be two or more interpretations possible of a given clause or a section or clauses. When legislature legislates, drafting no doubt is done by experts in the field. But it is not within the human powers to foresee conflict that may arise from such drafting and to provide for it free from all ambiguity. Our society is also changing from time to time. Socially, economically and politically, and hence certain laws enacted at the time and circumstances then prevailing may require to undergo some change from time to time. Hence the word interpretation plays significant role in the administration of law. So what is to be done in such a scenario? Let's proceed to understand the whole of this. Though this subject is very wide, I have made my best possible effort to concise in a manner that can cover important aspects of interpretation of statutes and how the courts looked at it. In the year 1966, in the case of South Asia Industries, Supreme Court has held that the object of interpreting a statute is to ascertain the intention of the legislature enacting it. In the famous R.S. Naik versus A.R. Athulia's case, the Supreme Court has held, if the words of a statute are clear and unambiguous, it is plainest duty of the court to give effect to the natural meaning of the words used in the provision. The question of construction arises only in the event of an ambiguity of the plain meaning of the words used in the statute would be self-defeating. What is statutory interpretation? Now, coming to this, statutory interpretation is the process by which courts interpret and apply legislation. In Nati Devi's case, in the year 2005, the Supreme Court has held that court always presumes that the legislature inserted every part of the statute should have effect. Sometimes the words of a statute have a plain and straightforward meaning, but in many cases there is some ambiguity or vagueness in the words of the statute that must be resolved by the judge, and the judges use various aids to interpret a statute. There are catena of judgments where the Supreme Court itself has opined as to why, when, and in what manner the court shall interpret a statute. And there are other sets of judgment where Supreme Court has also put restrictions as to court's power to interpret a statute. Example, the Oswald Agro Mills case, 1993 Supreme Court, and in the case of Nasruddin in the year 2003, and so on. In Nasruddin's case, it is held by the Supreme Court that the court can iron out the fabric but cannot change the texture of the fabric. It cannot change the scope of the legislation or intention when the language of the provision is plain and unambiguous. It cannot add or subtract words to a statute or read something into it which is not there. It cannot rewrite or recast legislation. Now, principles of interpretation. Now, the basic principle of statutory interpretation is that the words of a statute be read in their entire context and in their grammatical and ordinary sense, harmoniously with the scheme of the act, the object of the act, and the intention of the legislature. Now, what are the kinds of statute that we have to deal with? We deal with constitution, we deal with central acts, state acts, ordinance, bylaws, rules, regulations, notifications, circulars, instructions, clarifications, directions. So statute can be classified by various forms, maybe in the form of duration of a statute, nature of operation, and reference to objective. By duration of a statute means the statute could be perpetual statute where there is no duration fixed, or that it will be expiring only when it is repealed. Temporary statute, by its very meaning, is meant for a short period after which it will expire. Now, nature of operation of a statute means it could be a prospective, having a statute having a prospective effect, a retrospective effect, directory statute, mandatory statute. And when it comes to reference to objective, we have enabling statute, disabling statute, permissive statute, prohibitory statute, codifying statute, consolidating statute, curative or validating statute, repealing statute, amending statute. These are the types of statutes that having the effect over and for interpretation. Coming to different aids of interpretation. Now, we have internal aids and external aids. Internal aids are the aids which are found available in the statute itself. For example, the title of a statute, preamble of a statute, heading of a statute, marginal notes, definition, illustrations, punctuation, saving clause, proviso, and so on. So, coming to each one of these aspects, title. Title is very important part of the act, and this can be used to construct the scope of the act itself. For example, Indian Civil Procedure Code 1908. So that itself means it is a civil law and it is a procedure evolved for the civil law. Preamble. This gives scope, object, and purpose of the enactment of the act. For example, if an act is brought in or amended with an objective to benefit a particular class or section of the society, then one cannot read sections of such an act or amendment divorce its objective and not give effect to its objective. Headings of a particular chapter or section or group of sections help in knowing importance of that section, but in some cases courts have also held that heading cannot be controlling factor and one has to do cumulative reading of various provisions. Marginal notes. Courts have mostly held that the reference to marginal notes may be permissible in exceptional cases for construction of a section in a statute. However, in Bengal Humanities case, in the year 1955, the marginal notes appended to articles of the constitution are held to be part of the constitution. Definition. We all know definition is section 2 of every statute. Now, this definition clause cannot be ignored by the courts as it has twofold objective. One, it provides key to interpret any section or provision of the act which is later on provided thereunder. Two, the intention of the legislature is also to provide a detailed and true meaning at the first instance so that the entire act can be constructively read by shortening the reference to the words which you find under definition clause. It is extensive when definition uses the word, it means to apply and include. Sometimes we read words such as is deemed to include in the definition clause. Hence, provision is made to include something which in its ordinary meaning not included within it. We term this as deeming section. Illustration. Not many sections have illustration, but in some statute we find illustrations. Illustrations are the aids in interpretation, but it cannot modify the language of the section for which illustration is provided. For example, in Jamaa Masjid's case, 1962 Supreme Court, it is held that it is not to be readily assumed that an illustration to a section is repugnant to it and be rejected. Punctuations are put in the form of colon, semicolon, comma, full stop, dash, hyphen, brackets, etc. The rule of interpretation is that while interpreting the provision in a punctuated form, if court feels repugnancy or ambiguity, the court shall read the whole provision without any punctuation, and if the manner and if the meaning of is clear, will so interpret it without attaching any importance. Saving clause. Saving clauses are generally appended in cases of repeal and reenactment of a new statute. It is inserted in repealing statute. By this, the rights already created under repeal enactment are not disturbed, nor any new rights are created by it. In the case of conflict between the main part of the statute and a saving clause, the saving clause has to be rejected. Proviso. We find proviso after particular section or subsections in a given statute. Sometimes proviso is inserted by way of an amendment to make out an exception to the general rule or to qualify the section itself. Schedule. Schedule is to be always read with the main section. It coexists with the main section of the act and cannot be read in isolation. Sometimes there are formats prescribed, or sometimes some inclusions or exclusions is made by way of entries in the schedules. Because the text of the schedule is too lengthy or detailed, that statute cannot accommodate it conveniently. Hence, it is made part of a separate document. Explanation explains meaning to a section. It clears ambiguity to the main section. In Sundaram Pillai's case, Supreme Court has said that objects of explanation have been laid down in this judgment. Now coming to external aid. The external aid to which are guiding factors could be parliamentary material, speech, historical background, report of a committee or commission, official statement, judicial judgment, dictionary meaning, other statute to constitute one statute which are pari materia. For example, General Causes Act is a statutory aid. Foreign decision. Now, foreign decisions have persuasive value only and are not binding on Indian courts. Foreign judgments are referred in many of Indian judgments. Rules of interpretation. Fundamental rule is that the words and phrases used in the statute shall be given their ordinary meaning as per grammar. The rules of interpretation are not rules of law. They are guiding factors, and such of them which serve no useful purpose can be rejected and new rules can be evolved in their places. These are aids to construction, presumptions or pointers. In the case of Kanhaiya Lal in the year 1957, Supreme Court has held that the primary rule of construction is that the intention of the legislature must be found in the words used by the legislature itself. If the words used are capable of one interpretation, then the hypothetical construction will not be open to the court. Now, rules of literal interpretation most commonly used is the rule by the judges, lawyers and the expert. To literally construe means that to construe a provision literally, grammatically, giving the words that ordinary and natural meaning. It is also known as plain meaning rule. There should be no additions or substitutions of the words in the construction of statute and its interpretations. For example, in Ramavatar's case, a botanical meaning was not accepted by the Supreme Court and its ordinary meaning of betel leaves was accepted. Next is Golden Rule of Interpretation. It is a form of statutory interpretation that allows a judge to depart from a word's normal meaning in order to avoid an absurd result. Here lies the discretion of the judge. It is a compromise between the rule of interpretation and the rule of mischief. The same rule is to be used in two ways. It is applied most frequently in a narrow sense where there is some ambiguity or absurdity in the words themselves. It is used in a wider sense to avoid a result that is obnoxious to the principle of public policy. Mischief rule, a rule of statutory interpretation that attempts to determine the legislature's intention to determine the mischief and defect to give ruling to implement the effective remedy. This rule is discussed in details in Hayden's case. Four points are taken into consideration while interpreting a statute. What was the common law before making of the act? What was the mischief and defect for which the common law did not provide? What remedy the parliament had resolved and appointed to cure the disease of the commonwealth? What is the true reason of the remedy? Mischief rule is applicable where language is capable of more than one meaning. It is the duty of the court to make such construction of a statute which shall suppress the mischief and advance the remedy. For example, in the Bengal immunities case, Supreme Court applied the mischief rule in construction of Article 286 of the Constitution of India. After referring to the state of law prevailing in the province prior to the constitution, as also to the chaos and confusion that was brought about in interstate trade and commerce by the indiscriminate exercise of taxing powers by the different provincial legislatures founded on the theory of territorial nexus, Chief Justice S.R. Das stated it was to cure this mischief of multiple taxation and to preserve the free flow of interstate trade or commerce in the Union of India regarded as one economic unit without any provincial barrier that the constitution maker adopted Article 286 in the constitution. Now, rule of reasonable construction. This rule stresses upon the intention of the legislature to bring up the statute sensibly and not the prima facie meaning of the statute. This helps to clear the error caused due to the faulty draftsmanship. In RBI versus PLS General Finance and Investment Company Limited, the Supreme Court stated that if a statute is looked at in the context of its enactment with the glasses of the statute makers provided by such context, it is the scheme, the section, clauses, phrases and the words may take color and appear different than when the statute is looked at without the glasses provided by the context. With these glasses, we must look at the act as a whole and discover what each section, each clauses, each phrase and each word is meant and designed to say as to fit into the scheme of the entire act. Next is the rule of harmonious construction. This is a very famous rule. We normally use this in most of our matters. This is a rule where there is a conflict between two or more statute or two or more parts of a same statute, then the rule is to be adopted. If it is not possible to harmonize the two statute, then the court is to decide the same and it shall prevail. There should be consistency while construing this rule. The provision of one section cannot be used to defeat the provision in another unless the court, despite all its efforts, is unable to find a way to reconcile their differences. When it is impossible to reconcile the differences in contradictory provisions completely, the court must interpret them in such a way so that the effect is given to both the provisions as much as possible. Rule of beneficial construction. beneficial construction is a tendency and not a rule. This principle is based on human tendency to be fair, accommodating and just. In many cases where the statute is meant to benefit a particular section of the society, it is called beneficial legislation, and hence the beneficial construction comes into play. Rules of exceptional construction. It stands for the elimination of statutes and words in a statute which defeats the real objective of the statute. For example, and, or, may, shall, must. Rule of exuendum generis. It's a Latin expression meaning of the same kind and nature. This rule provides that where words of a specific meaning are followed by general words, the general words will be construed as being limited to person or things of the same general kind or class as those enumerated by specific word. Now this rule applies when the statute contains an enumeration of specific words, the subject of enumeration constitutes a class of category, that class or category is not exhausted by the enumeration, the general items follows the enumeration, there is no indication of a different legislative intent. The Supreme Court in Maharashtra University case has examined and explained the meaning of exuendum generis as a rule of interpretation of statute in our legal system. While examining the doctrine, the Supreme Court held that the expression exuendum generis is a principle of construction, meaning thereby when the general words in a statutory text are flanked by the restricted words, the meaning of the general words are taken to be restricted by implication with the meaning of restricted words. The Supreme Court has further held that the exuendum generis principle is a facet of the principle of nociter aesoesis. This is a Latin term used and it means it is known by the company it keeps. It is the concept that the intended meaning of ambiguous words depends on the context in which it is used. The Latin maxim nociter aesoesis contemplates that a statutory term is recognized by associated words. The Latin word soesis means society. Therefore, when the general words are juxtaposed with the specific words, general words cannot be read in isolation. Their color, their and their contents are to be derived from their context. But like all other linguistic canons of construction, the exuendum generis principle applies only when contrary intention does not appear. Finally, in conclusion, we can say that in furtherance to all the above guiding rules, it should be taken care that while interpreting the intention of a statute, no hardship, inconvenience, injustice, absurdity, and anomaly is avoided. Principle of sincerity, substantial justice, and fairness are to be applied. Inconsistency and repugnancy is to be avoided. Harmonious construction should be aimed at. Uncertainty or friction in the system, which the statute purports to regulate, has to be avoided.
Wow, that was an interesting talk on the interpretation of statutes by Advocate Swati Kamath. Thank you, Ms. Kamath. Before concluding today's session, a kind reminder to all of you. Do like, share this video, subscribe, and those who have not yet subscribed to this channel, kindly subscribe. Thank you so much. एहसास न्याय का सबके लिए आकाश न्याय का सबके लिए उल्लास न्याय का सबके लिए विश्वास न्याय का सबके लिए